This is a Choppin' It Up show brought to you by the Marching Podcast. And now here's your host, the Phantom Podcaster himself, Joe Beard.
Welcome to the Choppin' It Up show. I'm your host, Joe Beard, and happy to be of service for you. Happy, honored, and grateful to be creating, producing in this podcast from our new TMP studios. This episode is for June 2016. We appreciate all those listening through iTunes, YouTube, our blog, our website, Facebook, Twitter, or wherever you are on the interwebs. At the end of the broadcast, if you decide you like the show, then we appreciate a donation to the network if you feel so in your heart, of course. Just simply go to themarchingpodcast.com and click on the donate button to help improve the show and help build our scholarship fund. This podcast is brought to you by Double Time Entertainment, The Edge One Productions, Block Band Music and Publishing, and West Coast Westsiders. We hope you enjoy the show. Lots of folks ask how to follow or how to catch up on our shows. You can go to the website and click on the Listen and Follow tab. You will see a link to each one of our channels. Our old shows on Blog Talk Radio, you'll see the new shows from our new studio, but you'll also see our YouTube channel that you can subscribe to and our blog that you can subscribe to as well. Lots of folks are on YouTube, so check out that channel. And our blog is also a good place as well. So that's blog, the number four, so B-L-O-G, and then the number four, dot themarchingpodcast.com. Make sure to put your email in the top right corner of the page so you'll start to get an email or some type of notification when we release each podcast. We're also on Instagram at Marching Podcast, posting the episode trailers there. So if you like the visuals, and we're also now on Snapchat, hit us up at Marching Podcast and send us a chat about our show or our blog or whatever you want to say about the network. We will check out your post and read the info and post your info on the next show and give you a shout out as well. We don't have Blog Talk Radio anymore to call in, so you guys make sure you use Snapchat so we can keep this thing interactive. We chop it up with Ira Coleman and JP LaffSum. Now, most folks know Bam Bam and his mother, Roslyn Banks. Now, his mother, Miss Banks, wants to get him into a school to march, but it becomes difficult because he's homeschooled. So she reaches out to lots of schools, lots of organizations and colleges to help the young Bam Bam reach his dream. The hashtag for this is hashtag let him march, and that's L-E-T and then E-M. Okay, not let him march. Okay, not L-E-T-H-I-M, but let him march. Okay, so L-E-T-E-M and then M-A-R-C-H. All right, so hashtag let them march. You can go on Twitter and you can even go on Facebook now and check out the hashtags. But hashtag searches are much better when you do them on Twitter because you're getting the world's take on something and Facebook has a lot of other restrictions. So make sure you guys check that out and check out all the videos. Ira Coleman is also on YouTube as well, so you could check out all of the different things that he's doing. Anyway, seeing this made me laugh, but at the same time, I totally understand what she's trying to do because band is important. And we also stress that here on the network. So shout out to Bridget Bell. She's already on the network. She's the one who told me about it, and she sent it to my Facebook page, and I got to check it out. I reached out, and he got back with me, and the rest is history, as they say. I was really honored to do this interview, but also got an extra treat of talking to Ira Coleman and also talking to his colleague, JP LaffSum. Now, JP LaffSum is the one playing Bam Bam's mother there in the video. So we were really cool. We got a chance to talk to both of them, and we got a chance to holler at Bam Bam and Miss Roslyn as well. So we really appreciated their time and really excited to bring you guys this interview. In our first segment, we find out where Ira and JP LaffSum are from. And in this particular city, there's a huge event that makes a difference in people's lives. And you start to see how the material for Bam Bam starts to come into existence. And we also start the conversation about how they got into comedy. You can email the show at marchingpodcast@gmail.com, tweet us at Marching Podcast, or follow our blog, the4.themarchingpodcast.com. We hope you enjoy the show. You're now here with the Marching Podcast, and this time this is going to be really, really cool. Two great guests. We have JP LaffSum and Ira Coleman. How are you doing today, JP LaffSum?
I'm doing my best. How do you do today?
I'm doing well. Thank you so much for your time. And Mr. Ira Coleman, how you doing, sir?
Hey, man, I'm doing great. How about you?
I'm doing well, doing well. I want to say first, I love what you guys are doing and was really excited to see it. It spread like wildfire. And we'll get to the listeners so they'll know what we're talking about. But things are really, really good. You guys are really, really popular. A lot of talk about you guys everywhere. So I'm very grateful and honored that I got the interview, that you guys called me back, and we can set up this time. So I won't wait any longer, and I ask JP her questions first. JP, where are you from?
From Birmingham, Alabama. I was born and raised here.
Now, is your family and all of them from the Birmingham area?
Originally, everybody's pretty much from the Birmingham area. People have spread out, but majority of my family's here in Birmingham, yes.
Okay. And I asked you the same, Ira, man. Where are you from?
Straight out of Birmingham.
All y'all from Alabama, the great state of Alabama.
That's right. We got the best bands here. Alabama State, Alabama A&M, Tuskegee. You know what I'm saying? Everybody. This is the HBCU Mecca.
I was just about to say, y'all got Talladega, y'all got Miles, y'all got of them. Outside of HBCUs, I also hear University of Alabama's pretty good. I'm starting to hear more about PWI since I started doing this, so I hear they were good, and I hear that North Alabama is supposed to be really good.
Those schools, they all right with football or sports, but you know what I'm saying, We don't go to the game to watch the game for real. You know what I'm saying? We want to watch the bands get down.
Right, right. And plus the tailgating experience is two different things. You know what I'm saying? It's just, you know.
That's right.
Right. So that's what's up. So this is exciting. Okay, so now you guys are from Birmingham. So, JP, I ask you again, being there from Birmingham, what would you say was your first black college experience?
Grew up in Birmingham, Alabama, the home of the Magic City Classic. My first experience with that was the parade, the classic parade. I never was able to experience the football part of it as a child because it was so crowded and they wouldn't take me out because I'd probably get lost. Or they'd walk off and leave me, or something like that. Right. But they would take me to the parade. And I can remember at least to about 4 years old, just seeing the girls, those majorettes and those white boots and those drum majors and those capes and those big tall cotton ball hats, about 4 years old. Magic City Classic Parade, every year, rain, sleet, snow, cold, we're going to stand out there.
Ira, I asked you the same question, man. What was your first, I guess, HBCU experience down there in Alabama?
Well, I'll say mine goes back to, I actually was in private school all the way up till like middle school age, and I went to middle school here in Birmingham, and I got my first experience just with a black band. And after seeing the drum majors come in and do the lean back, I was hooked. So I got in the band in middle school, and then after that, I actually was involved in the Magic City Classic Parade. Okay. So somewhere around sixth grade, seventh grade, I was hooked, man.
Right, right. So now y'all growing up, y'all in the great state of Alabama, kicking it at the Magic City Classic. JP, where did you go to high school?
Huffman High School, class of 1900, and I'm not going to tell you.
I'm sure it was. I'm sure it was a couple months ago or something. I'm sure, you know.
Yeah, right, exactly.
Right. I asked you the same, Ira. Where'd you go to high school, man?
Carver High School, right here in Birmingham. Graduated in 2002.
We just gonna let everybody know we old. You were zoned for schools based on where you live, but you knew what school you wanted to go to based on who had the best band.
Okay.
So you trying to move and live with your real daddy so you can go to the best school. So you can go to the best school in the city so you can march in their band, but I could never find my real daddy.
Right. I was in middle school in the band and actually got to march in the parade, and the drum majors did a stare down with me. The high school drum majors did. It made me cry, man. So band is serious because they knew what to do. You know what I'm saying? So
right.
It's the reason why some kids go to college. You know what I mean?
Right.
I really am applauding your effort to spread it across the United States because it's a movement. Band life is a life. And unfortunately, that's why Bam Bam's running into so many problems. You have to go to school to be in the band. So if that's nothing but a reason to motivate somebody to go to school, whatever it takes to motivate you to go to school and reach a high level of education, if it's the band, so be it. Let them march.
Right. So around the time y'all were about to go to school, what school, JP, were you thinking about attending?
I wanted to march with the Alabama A&M Bulldogs. Oh. I wanted to go to that school because I wanted to march in that band. I wanted to wear maroon and white and high white boots. So I was going to roll with the Bulldogs, Alabama A&M.
Okay. Ira, same thing with you, man.
When I thought I was going to college, I wanted to go to JSU, the Sonic Boom of the South.
Oh, well, hey, man, you can't beat that. That's me, too. You know what I'm saying? I want to ask you, JP, did you end up going to school?
I did. I went to the community college inside my community.
Okay.
That didn't offer a football team, so therefore, you know, there was no band opportunity for me.
Right.
So I wasn't able to go to a university. I wasn't even focused on it once I met my baby daddy.
Right.
And it changed the whole script, you know. Right. I got involved and forgot about the band, you know, until October. So I was a little distracted, ended up going to the community college, not being able to go off to school, but still loving the whole band experience and really still desired to go to a university, but I just couldn't, you know. They didn't have a dorm for mamas and babies.
Right. Ira, same with you, man. Where did you end up going to school?
Life happened right after high school, so I ended up becoming an electrician. Went to a place called IEC, contracting school. I can't remember the name of it. Just ended up working, man. Okay. But I dated a few girls that went to A&M, so, you know, I was up there a lot.
Nice. You know. He's up there for the important stuff, you know what I'm saying?
That's right, right. Yeah, they thought I went up there.
Right. Always a bad time, so, you know.
You guys are now grown, as they say. I want to ask you, JP, how then did you then get into comedy?
Actually, kind of new to comedy. I haven't been 4 years. It'll be 4 years for me in October. And I've always found myself to be funny. I was raised as an only child and just kind of used my sense of humor to maneuver through life, through all the experience that I've had to overcome or whatnot. So coming in contact with people, they would always say, you miss your calling. You're so funny. You should have been a comedian, blah, blah, blah. Even when you're trying to be a stripper, they're telling you you should have been a comedian. So a couple years ago, well, three now, got a little confidence and went to try my luck at the open mic because the fear of rejection was stopping me from doing it. You know, I was okay in an intimate setting, but not with strangers and blah, blah, blah.
Right.
But I sprouted two little basketballs and went on out there and gave it a shot.
And directors, have you ever found yourselves in this situation? Showtime is quickly approaching. Your budget is quickly disappearing. Your music choices are narrowing. The equipment condition is wearing and your stress level is mounting. Stop what you're doing and contact Block Band Music and find out how we've got you. Check www.blockbandmusic.com, providing music, equipment, gear, and accessories to show style, core style, and traditional bands worldwide.
Hey, what's up? This is Byron Michaud, Lutheran North, class of 1996, University of Missouri, class of 2001, Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity, spring 2001. Currently, I'm working as a business analyst at U.S. Bank here in St. Louis. You're listening to the Marching Podcast Radio Network.
We're back, everyone. What I remember most about the first segment is how growing up in the South and how the Magic City Classic essentially shaped their lives. We as band heads can't appreciate that, but it's what we're trying to do essentially on this show and on this network. And it's the same thing that Miss Rosin's trying to do with her son. We want to show the world the importance of band and the difference it makes in young people's lives. It was cool to hear how much that one classic made a difference between the two of them. And it would be a really, really cool thing to have something like that in every state. In our second segment, we continue our conversation about how they got into comedy. They tell us the pros and cons about comedy. They tell us about their experiences doing stand-up. They get into and explain what their angle is in their material, which means like what type of comedian that they are, like what's their spin, what's their fighting style, if you will. Ira tells us where he gets his motivation on creating characters he plays. Like I said, you guys can go on to IColemanComedy either on Facebook or on YouTube and check out the list of videos that he has for all the different characters. He plays more than just Bam Bam. So he tells us a little bit about the motivation on where he gets a lot of those characters. Finally, in this part of the podcast, they tell us how they deal with using family and friends in their material. Somebody get mad at what you said, man, you weren't supposed to be saying that, man. They get into how they deal with those things in this second segment. You can email the show at marchingpodcast@gmail.com, tweet us at marchingpodcast, or follow our blog4.themarchingpodcast.com. What are you able to do to get over that? Because I'm not funny, but I'm silly. And I mean, of course, in my lifetime, I've made people laugh. But like, what's the difference? You going like on a stage where you don't know nobody and you not like in your dorm room laughing and being silly. How do you get over, I guess, the nerves, I guess? How do you get past that?
It's a perspective thing. It was initially for me. Like, I don't know them and they don't know me. I had to change my perspective. At first it was like, I don't know these people. They may not laugh. And then it was like, I don't know these people. They'll never see me again. I don't care if they laugh or not. Changed my attitude. I had a bad attitude about it. Forget them. If they don't laugh, forget them. So that's what made me confident enough to get on the stage. And when they did laugh, once I got the first laugh, it was over. Fell right on through. It was over. Once you get the first laugh, like the first touchdown, like the first successful performance of the season, whatever it is, after you get past the first one, you can do the rest of them, even if they're not all that good, but you're confident enough to try.
Mm-hmm. Did you have, like, because I've also seen, like, where comedians say they've had a bad experience. Like, Charlie Murphy, rest in peace, he went to Grambling a couple years ago, and it just turned out bad for the brother. Like, have you had any of those experiences?
I've had, you know, I call it crickets. I've had cricket moments. My first experience, I only had 5 minutes, stuck to the little material that I had conjured up, and I got laughs. I had a few cricket moments, but I had more laughs than cricket moments. After that, of course, as a performing artist, right, you go out there and you got all your jokes and you think they're funny, but you get some cricket moments. Then you figure out, okay, I need to take that out. I need to reroute my joke. I need to shorten it. I need to explain more. So you just figure it out. So the cricket moments aren't all that bad. Fortunately, I haven't had that many.
And that's good. And you haven't had any moments where people are like, we hate you, get off the road, and they start like throwing stuff at you, have you?
Nah, I hadn't had that happen to me yet, and I pray it never does. But I can probably tell you that I probably wouldn't have went back.
Right.
So that's the way my car's been done. I probably would have given up. I'm glad I hadn't had that opportunity.
All right, I remember. So Ash, I'm going to ask you the same question. When did you get into comedy? And I guess also, too, what was, like, your first open mic night? Like, what was the first night you actually had to perform?
Okay, cool. I always have been into comedy. I always have been funny all my life. I mean, from birth, basically, you know, always been a smiling baby, made everybody laugh in the house. I guess around 10 or 12, I started shooting my own videos. The old camera, which you put the cassette in, the VHS in. So I got footage from way back where I was shooting videos and clowning around in front of my parents and my other siblings. So, and from there, man, just at school, I guess I wasn't just your normal class clown. I was so good at making everybody laugh that the other teachers would actually give me 15 minutes of class. You know what I'm saying? The first 15 minutes, they said, "Ira, it's yours." The other teachers would come watch, just have a ball. So I knew I was good at that. And the first time I performed was at the Star Dome open mic. I guess I was 18 years old. I actually did really, really well. No booing, everybody laughing. It was all good. So then I decided to take my talents to Atlanta and went to the Uptown Comedy Corner. And that's where it got real for me. I learned that comedy was totally different when you start traveling other places. So I got booed off stage. I mean, booed out of the building. They ran me and my brother out of the building. He was just with me. So it didn't just happen just getting booed straight off. I actually was doing good, but I forgot my set. And over there, man, they didn't give you a chance. Once you forget and you stand there and didn't say nothing for 10 seconds, they started to boo it.
Wow.
And the host was not hosting. He clowned me. But it made me stronger. So I didn't quit. I actually went back a few times and succeeded. And then just over the course of years, you know, more life happened. Got married, had some children, slowed down a little while, and I guess when I got around 28, 29, I just had a burn inside where I had to go back and get back at it. Went out there to open mic again, same comedy club here in Birmingham, the Star Dome, won the competition there, and then went on the big stage and won. And from there, I just said I wasn't going to ever bag off. So it all of a sudden, you know, just got better and been able to just do it.
Is that like necessary in comedy, JP, that you gonna mess up or something bad is gonna happen?
Yes, because, you know, what's funny to me may not be funny to you, and the way that I imagine it to come out of my mouth is not the way it came into your ear. So you have to, okay, figure out another route to get it to the funny so that your audience can receive it. So it's definitely necessary because you're dealing with people who have different perspectives. You're dealing with people who speak not necessarily a different language, but, you know, you can even pick up on us. We're from the South.
Right.
So some words, we don't even say the same as other people would. And, you know, when you're dealing with different audiences, you want to be able to be transparent to them both. If I say supper in a joke in the South, people going to know I'm talking about dinner. If I go upstate and I say supper, they're going to be like, what? Nobody calls dinner supper up there.
Right.
So it's definitely necessary. Okay, I don't need to say that because they didn't laugh. That was a cricket moment for them because it was a disconnect. So it's definitely necessary when you're doing comedy, when you're doing something, because comedy is communication.
One of the Bam Bam videos, he was driving and you was like the aura. Or the actress, of course. She was like, oh, Bam Bam Mama. She's like, the aura. What's the aura? The aura. You know what I'm saying? The aura. Two syllables.
Exactly.
Right. See, I ain't heard aura in a minute. You know what I'm saying? So.
But you knew exactly what it was.
Yeah. And it's just, you know? I hadn't heard. Or even Let 'Em March. You know what I'm saying? That's spelt like somebody from the South wrote it. You know what I'm saying? So,
that's right. It's a phrase. It's not right. Even... three words anymore. It's just a phrase. It's
right.
One word. It's a word now.
So now I want to ask you guys about your form of comedy. So JP, are you like stand up? Are both you guys do stand up? Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. So I notice Ira does like a lot of characters, or like I guess he'll create a character. Like, what's my man?
Theotis,
Rutherford or Theotis? I hadn't heard of Theotis before. That's
Theotis.
Yeah.
I'm actually a storyteller. I've gotten into character a few times prior to getting with Ira, but I'm usually just I'm a regular stand-up comedian. I'm a storyteller.
Storyteller.
That's my aim.
Okay.
I'm a storyteller. Roslyn usually doesn't hit the mic. You know, you get JP last on because I'm a story to be told myself, my life.
Right, right.
So Roslyn doesn't even hit the stage. And same thing with Ira. You're going to get Ira Coleman. He's a storyteller. He's a storyteller. When he hits the mic, same thing.
Well, Ira, I guess same question for you. You're a storyteller as well?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I tell stories, say a lot of stuff that I guess wouldn't be relevant to life. Just pure ignorance on stage. I like everybody to have a good time. I want everybody laughing, white, black, old, young, gay, straight. I'm going to talk about everybody, every situation, and then I'm going to focus a lot on myself, the way I grew up, my parents. That's it.
Ira, how do you create a character? How does the process goes where, like, you create, like, in existence, Bam Bam and Rutherford and, like, some of these, how do they come into existence, I guess?
My mind is just completely messed up. I went, like, Rutherford. My parents, they were older when they had me. They were in their 40s when they had me. So, you know, I've seen all the old, sitting around the old school parties, the house parties, and it's always a guy, you know, who everybody think can sing. And he would stand up and sing. And one of my dad's buddies, he actually was in prison for like 40 years or whatever. Before I was even born, he was in prison. But got a chance to see him get out of prison, and he still thought he could sing. And he had his hair was kind of like that. So that's really where that one came from, just something I saw. And, you know, you would think that this guy was an R&B legend just the way he walked around and talked to everybody. He was still stuck in that era. So that's where Rutherford comes from. Bam Bam, I would say, just came from the true drum major experience that I had in middle school, seeing the bands in high school. Also, somebody in my family who he's not homeschooled. Where you would think he was homeschooled. So
okay.
I kind of just put them together, let it go.
Okay, so that actually rolls over to the next question I got to ask you both. And this is something I've always wondered about comedians. Let's say you, just like Ira just said, you've got some remnants of some folks in your mind to either maybe tell a joke or a story or create a character. JP, has you ever told a story and someone you who was in that story, like, they didn't want you to tell it? Or have you like, let's like you make a joke and then you call your friend, you're like, hey girl, you know, I need to actually talk about the time when you and I was, you know what I'm saying? Have you ever had like a personal where you had to tell family members, like, oh, well, it was just a joke, you know, I was just using this for material? Have you ever had an instance like that?
JP LaffSum exposes her story. So if you just so happen to know me, you are part of my story.
Hi, everyone. This is Joe Beer, the Phantom Podcaster and owner and founder of The Marching Podcast. I want to tell you guys about this website, theedgeonepro.com. That's DAEDGE1PRO.com. This is the website of my man, Gary Edgerson, the media director for Southern University's Human Jukebox. If you want to see great bands and a good idea of the HBCU experience, log into theedgeonepro.com. Garrett has photos and videos of events on campus, along with parades of bands of all levels. So check out the Edge One Productions and theedgeonepro.com.
Hi, this is Thaddeus Dixon, crab of 1994 from that famous sonic boom of the South, class of 2000 from the Jackson State University. And guess what? You're chopping it up with the Marching Podcast Network.
We're back, everyone. What I remember most about the second segment is how Ira said that he had a bad experience and he basically got ran out of the building in Atlanta. And JP hadn't had too many bad experience. She did coin a term called crickets, so I thought that was pretty cool. Also thought it was special that his teachers gave him 15 minutes to start class. So shout out to all you teachers out there. How cool is it that in your lesson plans you just block out the first 15 minutes of class so you don't have to do anything because your students gonna take over and make the class laugh? So I'm sure that that was special. And they both explained to us that they're both storytellers, even though Ira does do the different characters or whatnot, they both consider themselves storytellers. So very good information. In our third segment, they get more into talking about exposing family and some of their experiences. And they talk about how they met and how the skit of Bam Bam came to be. You can email the show at marchingpodcast@gmail.com, tweet us at marchingpodcast, or follow our blog, blog4.themarchingpodcast.com.
Joke that came to mind when you were asking the question was, I have an ex-husband, and I tell a joke about it. At the time when the joke was being told and it was being developed, the storyline was he was my husband. I just married him. And as the storyline went on, he became my ex-husband. So, you know, I had to tell the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help me God. Right. And the truth got told with the humor. The people loved it, but he wasn't a fan, you know. And some people come up all the time, is this true? Is that true? I love when you say that. Is that true, girl? Yeah, that's not true. Yeah, all this stuff is true. I've just put a humorous twist on it or given you my humorous perspective on it, but it's all true. So, yes, he didn't want the story to be told because I exposed him a little bit. But I told him, I said, people don't believe that. If he ever hears this, he's going to have to understand people don't believe that.
Right.
People don't believe that's true. They don't know I'm talking about you.
Right. Say with you, Iron Man, have you had, like, an experience or have you had to, like, explain yourself to someone for some, like, the material that you use?
Nah, man, I talk about everybody. I talk about my mama in front of her. I tell you. If I like something that you're doing, something you're wearing, and I feel like it's humorous, I'm gonna tell you to your face. Listen, I'm gonna do this. If I'm around you. But other than that, if I just see it and I want to do it, I'm gonna put it on stage. I talk about my mom, my parents on stage a lot, and they've been to the shows. They don't mind. They just tell me every time, look, when the check comes, cut us a little bit out.
Right. You said just your experiences with the drum major. How did you guys get together and were able to put that together? Because you also got the hashtag let 'em march. So how were y'all able to put that together?
I'm the brain of it all. She had nothing to do with Dodge this kid. So I met her at the comedy club one night backstage, both at the open mic. And anyway, the back up, her hair was nappy at the back. So I rubbed her head and I was like, look, you need to, I got a sister that do hair. And, you know what I'm saying, she could help you out. So that was how we met.
And tell them how it happened when you woke up, because you're talking about a dream. So tell them what really happened when you were awake. That happened when he's in his sleep, sir.
So when we got to the Bam Bam deal, now I actually came up with the concept. I told him about a skit I wanted to do, and I knew I wanted her to do it because she's very witty, smart, and I knew she could just talk and come up with the dialogue that I needed. So that part, I guess, coming up with the character was mine, but her character, Roslyn, she came up that with the name herself. She might even came up with the name Bam Bam, and she's actually a big part of it. The Let It March, I think we might have both just been talking about it, but she actually told me to hashtag it, put it in there. So like I said, it's 50-50 collaboration on that. Let me see. So some of the stuff dealing with, you know, I just give a – in the beginning, I was just giving her the concept that I wanted to portray or put out there about him being homeschooled. This guy wants to get in a public school band. They won't let him march. All of the dialogue that you see on the first video, I think it's got 1.9 million views. Mike Epp shared it. All of that dialogue is her. We just work well together. I'm not even around the camera, as you can see, while she's talking, so I don't even know what she's saying. I actually just walk up to the camera, you know, and say some stuff while she's there. It just works. It works every time that way. We have a lot of fun doing the videos. And I figured it would be pretty big. I did not think it would be this big. But I dream big anyway, so I really can't say that. And plus, I'm the brain of it all. You know what I'm saying? Hold on.
Or the butt of the joke. Or the butt of the joke.
So was that pretty much accurate, JP? Just asking, was that pretty much, was that your story as well, or how y'all got together with this?
Well, put 50% of a co-signature on there, just my first name, that's about the size of it. It's been good. He came to me, said, this is what I want to do. Let me know what you want to do. Let me know about it. I said, okay. When he came to me with the initial idea, I was like, hey, some things going to have to change about it because I don't want anybody offended. I want it to be able to go across everybody. I want everybody to catch the humor in it. So we got to do it like this. And I thought about it for about a week, and I called him back. I said, hey, this is how we need to do it. What do you think? He's like, yeah, that's cool. We'll do it. Let's get together. I got a look because I wanted to separate Roslyn from JP.
Okay.
I said, let's do it like this. You know, let me look a little bit different because I don't want to be myself in this. So came up with a look, had the storyline, and been meeting up at these little outdoor locations, indoor locations, wherever we can get together, and been trying to pull it off every week ever since. JP is a parent, so I take my parent energy and I put her in the Roslyn.
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't able to go off to college because I had a baby.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, you know how parents are. Hey, I want to live out my dreams for my kids.
Right.
So I want Bam Bam to Mars just as much as I wanted myself to Mars when I was little. So the whole energy goes toward it. It's real.
Right, right.
It's real.
JP, do you have anything that people should know about you, anything that's coming up that people should be aware of or something that you wanted to share out with everyone?
My comedy hasn't zoomed across the universe, but it is booming here in the city, thank God. June 17th, there's a big comedy show that I'm a part of with three other comedians, and actually four. Well, three other comedians. There's four comedians on the show. It's at the BJCC. It's the Mofo Head and Face 2 comedy show here in the city of Birmingham. Benny Mac's headlining. Comedian Felicia is featuring. And Big E is hosting the show, and it's June 17th. And I know of a big show that'll be going on September 3rd with Ira Coleman. Both he and I be doing a show together. But other than that, they need to look me up on the book, Facebook. I'm JP Space LaffSum, and I try to do drops and post flyers of the next shows. But I don't have any limits other than the ones that I'm putting on myself. So just keep your eyes peeled and your ears open for Roslyn, even if she's not dressed up. She's still JP, so you'll hear me again.
Ira, same thing, man. Is there anything that you wanted people to know about, or you have something coming up on the horizon for us to be excited about?
A lot more videos, a lot to make people laugh there. The main thing I want to push is the big, I'm shooting my hour special, September 3rd. It's going to be at the Red Mountain Cabaret Theater here in Birmingham. So I get a home city a chance to come out. It's going to be filmed, you know, live taping, 1 hour special. JP will be there. We might even do the Bam Bam skit live on stage. I hadn't decided that yet. And you can definitely look out for us next year. We're going to be touring comedy clubs, the whole movement, man. We're gonna push it all the way. You've seen the Relifer Jones videos, the young lady in the Relifer Jones videos working out with me. That's comedian Felicia. She'll be helping me out with some stuff. They're just good people. I like to call them my staff. They listen to me. They follow instructions well.
You like to call us volunteers. That usually requires some kind of W.
I hadn't paid them yet. That's what she's hollering about in the background.
The volunteer crew.
But a lot more comedy coming up. I'm also going to do my own sketch comedy show. We're going to film that here in Birmingham, but you'll be able to find it on my YouTube channel, which is IColemanComedy. Follow me on Instagram, Facebook, IColemanComedy.
Double Time Entertainment. Our passion is music and promoting HBCU marching bands as well as high school marching bands through high-quality movie videos and photos. We have worked with BET, Yamaha, Ludwig, Honda Motor Company, and been featured on CNN and Lifetime Network's series, Bama State Style. We also help and orchestrate Battle of the Bands with marketing and promotions, and also became the official media team for the Queen City Battle of the Bands in Charlotte, North Carolina. Join Double Time Entertainment on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube, and now new on Periscope. Music lovers are noteworthy.
Hello, this is Professor Snipes with the Miles College Purple March Machine. You are chopping it up here on the Marching Podcast Network.
We're back, everyone. What I remember most about the third segment is how Ira started joking about how they met, and he said he had a sister that did hair and how he could help her out. I thought that was funny. But then when he was also explaining about that she's working with him and she and he's working with other comedians, she said that, oh, we're the volunteer crew because the staff will require some type of W-2. So I thought that was cool, but definitely they were, you know, getting in at each other right there on that segment. I thought that was funny. Also, it was cool that Rosalind pointed out that she didn't get a chance to march, so a lot of her energy in the character was through her kids, and how we want to live life through our kids sometime made me think of LaVar Ball. If you sports fans, you guys know I'm into sports. LaVar Ball is, was that his name? Okay, oh yeah, his son is Alonso, and his father is LaVar. You know how he's not able to reach the depths that his son has. So, you know, being the son's agent or being the co-branding, whatever it is, he's leading the charge to get his son in the best place to play ball. And it's no different from what Miss Rosalind is doing, Miss Rosalind Banks. But for you folks out there, you know, feeling Rosalind, she's got the videos and she's got the t-shirts or whatnot, but she's not selling them for $400 or $500 or whatever the shoes are. We got to give Rosalind a shout out because, you know, she's not trying to break us down. But it's the bomb. I really appreciate when folks or parents are in each other or their kids' lives. But I thought it was really cool. And finally, they wrapped it up talking about the events and performances that are coming up. In our fourth and final segment, we actually talk now to Bam Bam and Rosalind Banks. We find out how old Bam Bam is, and we find out the top schools on his list. Because, you know, he's trying to get into school. I think they said that, well, I'll let you guys, I'll let them tell you all about what's going on. You can email the show at marchingpodcast@gmail.com, tweet us at marchingpodcast, or follow our blog, blog4.themarchingpodcast.com. You're now here with the Marching Podcast, and we always have great guests, but this time I really wanted to reach out to the community to help out. I felt myself that I needed to do something using this platform to help out someone because I believe in what they're doing. And you know us on the network, it's all about higher education. So we are happy to have a student that is ready to march a drum major at a school, and we'll work out the parameters for that. But his name is Bam Bam, and his mother, Rosalind.
I'm Rosalind Banks, and my son's name is Darius Banks, yes, sir. We call him Bam Bam, but his name is Darius, yes, sir.
Okay, so Darius, would you like me to...
Hold on, wait just a minute. Don't blow that whistle. You see me on the phone. Okay. Get it out your mouth. Okay. I'm sorry, sir.
That's okay. Now, was he mad at me? Do I need to call him Darius or Bam Bam? Is that okay? Or?
You can call him Bam Bam, but you said that was his name. We called him Bam Bam. His name is Darius.
Okay, yeah. Okay.
Just Bam. Give it to me.
Yeah, I didn't. So Miss Banks, is it?
Roz is fine. They call me Sugar. Yeah, either one.
Oh, can I roll with Sugar?
Sugar is fine. Sugar. Okay. S-U-G-A, Sugar. Mm-hmm.
Sugar, when did you want Bam Bam to march in a band? When did you notice that he had these special skills?
So it might have been Magic City, Classic, Parade. 2000, oh gosh, he was about four years old, and I used to take him to the classic parades, and he loved the band. He almost got ran over one time trying to march with the band, and I knew then my son had what it takes and wanted to be in the band. So it's been a long time in the making, but once I pulled him out of the public school system, because the kids were so cruel and the teachers were too, I realized that the opportunity for him to be able to march, you know, it was diminishing. And I meant diminishing or whatever.
Right.
So I knew that I had to do something to get my son in a band. I went to the city schools. I went to the county schools. None of them would allow him to participate because he wasn't a member of their school. He went on the road, but he was in the homeschool association school. And, you know, it take a village to raise a child. So some of the people in my family was helping me homeschool him. But they wouldn't give him an opportunity. So I said, no big deal. I'm going to go to the community. because they got shows on TV showing people's talents off and giving them opportunities. So I put my son on the internet, and I asked you guys to help me let him march. And y'all been doing a great job sharing the videos, liking them, getting us involved with different auditions. You know, even though the talent that my son possesses hasn't really been recognized by those people, that don't mean he's still not talented, you know. So I'm still on it. I'm trying to get my boy in front of a marching band this year, actually. I'm hoping he can go to the Classic. That's the big deal. I need my boy in the Classic. So I'm trying to get him wrapped up in this homeschool. We're trying to expedite his lesson, you know, and get him graduated. Hopefully so he can get into college in the fall. They didn't know that, but now you got it. We about done with the high schools because they don't recognize talent. And I understand that. They limited. So we're going to get Bam Bam hopefully into college by the fall.
So I have to ask, because I kind of feel like it's an elephant in the room. Bam Bam's, he's, how old is he now?
Bam Bam is 15, but his birthday next month.
He's 15? I guess when I didn't know, when I say Bam Bam and I saw him, I was like, wow, he's great. But then kind of look at him, you said that he was kind of big for his age.
Right. His real daddy tall.
Okay. So, well, yeah, he's tall, but he looks older than 15. I guess maybe that's maybe some of the resistance.
It's probably the hair. I don't let the barber shave his hair off his face. I figure if it's growing, God wanted on there for a reason. So I let him wear his beard. I mean, that's probably all it is. In the hormones, you know, they chickens, churches, and the chickens, they feed them all kind of stuff. So
I was thinking maybe he was so big to do certain moves. So does he really like the back bend, Bam Bam? Do you like the back bend, brother?
Yes.
Do he like the back bend? Don't you see him do the back bend? And he like to hit the split. What do you mean? Do he like the back bend? He love the back bend. Do you like the back bend, sir?
Well, I tell you.
That. I just took that out your hand, boy.
He actually had a drum major competition against another guy. Do you remember that?
I do.
Okay. The other guy was able to go to the ground. Because, you know, black colleges, you know, because I want to help him get to the Classic. I think the back bend is what we got to work on first.
We are actually practicing on that. I know most of the videos consist of their practice. And practice makes habit because nobody's perfect. So don't get it twisted, okay? Oh. So my son is practicing to get in the habit of sticking it. But you said the man made it to the ground. Bam Bam make it to the ground every time, sir. So it's really about perspective. What is a successful back bend? Because when he hit the ground and hit the split, I mean, I think that's just fine.
So the guy from Alabama A&M.
Correct. Mr. Simmons.
Okay. Is he still working with Bam Bam?
Yes, he still works with Bam Bam. I've had to pay him more because he told me that Bam Bam was learning slower and he was going to take more time, so I had to pay him more, but that's no problem. I'm raising funds for that, too. We're selling shirts now. The guy is actually a former Alabama A&M drum major, and he does still work with him to help him because he wants to see my son reach his goal as well. So he'll be ready.
I got a new whistle.
Shut up, Bam Bam. That man ain't asked you that.
Well, actually, I was going to say that because he actually plays the whistle. Is that correct?
Correct. Okay. Correct.
So a lot of times when he goes to march, they may put him on an instrument first. So are you prepared that he may have to pick up something else, let's say maybe other than the whistle?
Yeah, so he is an excellent whistle player, but right now he's getting trombone lessons. Because it seems that would be a requirement for some of these bands, and I had never heard of it before. I think it's crazy because the drum major stand in the front and blow the whistle. He don't blow the any horn. He don't beat a drum. He blow the whistle. Stop, Bam Bam. Put it up. He blows the whistle. And in order to be a drum major, I don't think you should have to play any instrument. You blow the whistle. That's what my son does. But, you know, we want to play the game, so we play by their rules. But he's taking trombone lessons right now. They're going to have to come with something else.
Okay.
I got a pee-pee soon.
Hey, shut up, Bam Bam. She's going to the bathroom, man. So please hurry up. He need me to.
So, like, we do, like, the national side, like, Bam Bam. Because, really, he's really a blue-chip athlete. You know what I'm saying? What?
He's really what, sir?
A blue-chip athlete? You know, like,
I don't know what that is.
So, like, Shaq and LeBron, you know, and Kobe when they were in high school. You know, the only difference is
I know you like LeBron. The man didn't ask you that, Bam Bam, please.
You like LeBron, Bam Bam? I'm a LeBron fan too, Bam Bam.
He played for Miami.
I got him a Miami LeBron jersey. He don't know. Go ahead. Bam Bam, stop talking, please.
So he's in Cleveland now. Did you know that, Bam Bam?
No, he played for Miami.
Oh, okay. Ms. Rosin, I don't wanna hold you too much longer. What schools is Bam Bam gonna choose from? Does he have like some favorite schools that he likes to be a part of?
You already know the top two that he's seen growing up: Alabama State and Alabama A&M University, the Magic City Classic. My son don't watch a lot of TV because I don't think that it's a lot of stuff on there that he needs to see. Okay.
Okay.
One is an hour and a half away. One is 2 hours away. So right now we're between Alabama State and Alabama A&M because I'm gonna have to get them to practice. Hashtag and let them march. We need them sharing those videos. We need them buying T-shirts because Mr. Simmons done went up on the training rate.
That's right.
I'm having to buy my son I got him a uniform at the thrift store, but I got to get it adjusted. That costs money. A lot more fabric got to be bought. I have to burn a lot of gas, you know what I mean? And I got to feed him. So all that's got to be done for this movement to go down. Buy these T-shirts, share these videos. Turn it up!
Well, I'm excited for you, and I just want to say, Miss Rosalind Banks, for you, you are the type of mother that is making the world go round. So I want to give you a round of applause here. You might not hear it, but
I hear it. Thank y'all so much. There's so many people in there. I didn't know you had all the people in there. Hey, everybody. Thank you.
Yeah, we got the little studio audience. They was listening to everything, but... But yes, that's very, very excited for you.
So I keep telling him that ain't even the right one. I got that other whistle tuned up.
Is Bam Bam, would you like to say anything before we close the podcast?
I want to be in the band.
All right.
I'm a drum major. Do you like me?
Oh, yeah. Me and you cool, man. You know, we like LeBron. You know what I'm saying? We going to go down to Miami and watch him play.
Oh, yeah. I like that. Got to take my mama.
I'd be honored to. I'd be honored to. So we going to Miami, y'all.
I got a new headband.
Okay, Bam Bam. Thank you.
All right, everyone. If you're interested in becoming a sponsor or a patron to the Marching Podcast, please contact the show and we'll give you the criteria so we can start to pub your business using our platform. We'll play your commercial, we'll post your website on our blog, and we'll help send out your information through social media. So contact us so we can help build your business. I love talking to Rosalind and Bam Bam, and they could go all day in their characters. One thing I thought about was she says that she got Bam Bam a uniform at the thrift store. One of the last videos, Bam Bam and his mom are out somewhere, and they find a uniform, or they say that they have a uniform jacket from Tuskegee. And my immediate thought was Tuskegee is getting on the ball. And this was like a plug for the school. Ira told me that he got some flack for posting on that video and even having the uniform on it all or just having do anything with the uniform. It was perceived as disrespectful. So for the listeners, a lot of these performances at our HBCU events and games, at the end of the year, you are supposed to turn your uniform in. And you're supposed to turn in your hats. What they do, because some people were actually taking the uniforms, they would say, okay, fine, we're going to hold this uniform until you graduate. So then once you try to graduate or you submit it, they would put the bill for your uniform there on for you to graduate. The problem is that you would not be able to graduate without turning in. If it is returned, they give you the bill for like the cleaners. Like, no lie, like, they are dead serious about this. And now it's even to the point now where it says, okay, well, these people may not graduate, they will now hold having your uniform before you can even register for the next semester. A lot of people have taken it seriously. I think it started a big debate, but a lot of folks are mad at IRA and, like I said, perceived it as disrespect for even having the uniform. Talked to him about it, and he said that he didn't buy the uniform. They just had it, but he was surprised. And I think to him and I talk, and he understands what's going on now. Very similar to like frat shirts, and of course y'all know we the bros. Don't make us fight the cutes, the bros. So people understand. Okay, somebody walk around with a Q shirt on, and they ain't the Qs. So you can kind of like, hey, like, oh, well, you kind of know what's gonna happen after that. So it was that way for all the Tuskegee folks. So I'm just saying shout out to everybody involved. I know Ira was not trying to be disrespectful. And even his reaction to some people may have even seemed indifferent. He just didn't know, just didn't understand. We believe that it'll be resolved amicably.
Hey, what's up? This is Byron Michaud, Lutheran North, class of 1996, University of Missouri, class of 2001, Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity, spring 2001. Currently, I'm working as a business analyst at U.S. Bank here in St. Louis. You're listening to the Marching Podcast Radio Network.
Hi, this is Thaddeus Dixon, crab of 1994 from that famous sonic boom of the South. Class of 2000 from the Jackson State University. And guess what? You're chopping it up with the Marching Podcast Network.
Hello, this is Professor Snipes with the Miles College Purple March Machine. You are chopping it up here on the Marching Podcast Network.
We've come to the end of our podcast. I want to give a melancholy shout out to Prodigy of Mobb Deep, one of my favorite rap duos. It was always between them and Outkast for me. But like Outkast, Mobb Deep, that was like, those was my two things. I rode with both of them super, super hard. But they were a part of me growing up. Shout out to Avery McFadden, brass expert to the network, and my roommate in college, guy that got me studying, yada yada yada. I can go on and on. Had one of the dopest CD collections I had ever seen. Y'all remember back in the day we had the CDs and those vinyl fold zip up CD folders. Well, McFadden had like two big ones. He had one that was like jazz and one that was hip hop. Well, it was dope. But I remember I used to like add my CDs with his, so it looked like it was mine too. Anyway, McFadden loved him some Mobb Deep, and I have to say, like, I knew about him in high school, but he really like pushed it over the edge for me. He came to Jackson State rapping everything from the infamous the Cradle to the Grave album. He just loved Mobb Deep, man. So it was real cool later on when we were there in school. Prodigy then came out with his solo album, HNIC, one of my favorite all-time albums. It was the first album that I remember where I was old enough to recognize the scenes from the movies using the album. On the HNIC, I heard the title joint from the movie Lean On Me, where it was Benson. Y'all know Benson. Benson was in Lean On Me. And he's, contrary to popular belief, I'm the... So of course, that was on there. And then Kane from Menace to Society, when he pulled up on the dude at the fast food drive-in, and he's like, man, we supposed to be brothers. You know, you try to kick some knowledge. You try to kick, man, you know what I'm saying? So really excited about all of those things. But this track plan now is Dealt With The BS, and it's one of my favorite Prodigy verses of all time. And anyway, RIP Prodigy. Check out the website and donate what's in your heart to themarchingpodcast.com. Like us on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter. Thanks to you for listening. And remember, the eye is a better pupil and more willing than the ear. Advice may be misleading, but examples are always clear. See you next time.